Hello students, and welcome to the history class of standard 7. Today we are going to start with chapter 7, the administration of the Swaraj, presented by Sara Pereira. Shivaji Maharaj founded Swaraj. He had himself crowned. After the coronation, Maharaj accomplished Dakshin Digvijay, the conquest of the south. The Swaraj expanded, comprising large areas of Nashik, Pune, Satara, Sangli, Kolhapur, Sindhudurg, Ratnagiri, Raigad, and Thane districts of Maharashtra. It also included parts of Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu states. To ensure the smooth management of the affairs of the Swaraj and to ensure people's welfare, Shivaji Maharaj set up an efficient administration. We shall get some information about it in this chapter. Ashtapradhan Mandal, Council of 8 Ministers. At the time of his coronation, Shivaji Maharaj appointed a council of 8 ministers. Who these 8 ministers were and what their designation and their work was, that we will do in the next slide. But all these 8 ministers, you can see in the image, they were appointed at the time of coronation. Okay, when the Swaraj was actually established as a sovereign state that time. The administration was divided into 8 departments. Okay, and all these 8 ministers were made head of every department. Under every person, there was a different committee, different council. And because they were 8, the name is Ashtapradhan Mandal. A head was appointed for each department. These 8 heads of department constituted the Ashtapradhan Mandal. Maharaj alone had the power to appoint a minister or to remove him from his position. All these 8 ministers were appointed by Maharaj. Okay, he was the person who had the entire control to appoint and to remove. And the ministers were answerable to Maharaj for the administration of their respective departments. If any problem was there in their department, if any solution was to be found, the Maharaj was directly to be reported by this Ashtapradhan Mandals, and they were responsible solely for whichever department they were responsible of. Okay, so they had to answer whenever Maharaj would ask them question that why these things are not going according to how it should be going, or why these things are like this. So they were answerable to him, and they should have answered. They couldn't do any kind of cheating. They could not do any kind of corruption. Okay, because they had to give the entire report to Maharaj time to time. Shivaji Maharaj selected the council on the basis of their merit and achievements. He just did not select them because he wanted to, but looking at their achievements, whatever merits were there, whether they are capable or no, whether they will be able to fulfill their duties well or no, all these things were taken into consideration, and he had put a lot of trust in them. These were all trusted people. Okay, so if they would not do their duties well, then only Shivaji Maharaj had the authority to remove them. But that was another case. These were all very trusted and very efficient leaders, very true and very loyal to Shivaji Maharaj. And that's why Shivaji Maharaj had appointed them. He did not give them jagirs, vatans, or gifts or fees. Now, these were kind of salaries at the time of in the medieval age, that these were the salaries that were paid to the sardars. Okay, that we have done in the previous chapter also, that the sardars were given jagirs, they were given vatans, okay, kind of land, okay, which they were given complete control of. They would rule that land, they would collect the revenue in that territory, and they became the head. So this was their reward, this was their gift, this was their salary for the work that they did. But Shivaji Maharaj did not do that. He He gave handsome salaries. Handsome salaries is whatever amount that leader or that mantri or minister, whatever he deserved, was given to him in the kind of salary. Okay, when Shivaji Maharaj got coronated, he had printed coins, gold coins and copper coins. So Shivaji Maharaj gave salaries to his ministers rather than giving them land, or because sometimes what happens, if that that land would be a fertile land or a revenue that would be equivalent to their salaries, but then sometimes we cannot guarantee about the outcome. So Shivaji Maharaj, he thought of giving them salaries rather than giving them land. So this was about the Ashtapradhan Mandal. Now let us see in the next slide the names of these Ashtapradhan Mandals and their designation and the work that they had to do. Ashtapradhan Mandal of Shivaji Maharaj. First is Moro Trimbak Pingale. He was the Pradhan and his work was running the administration and making arrangements for the conquered territories, whichever territories were conquered, they were established or they were captured by Shivaji Maharaj. He was Moro Trimbak Pingale. He was in charge of making arrangements for it, appointing an administrator there, looking after the administration, appointing army there. All this was done by the Pradhan, Moro Trimbak Pingale. Second is Ramchandra Nilkanth Mujumdar. He was Amatya, keeping the accounts of the state. We can call him the clerk, okay, who was responsible for looking after the accounts. Third is Annaji Datto. He was Sachiv, preparing royal edicts. Royal edict is whatever rules were passed, whatever decisions were made. He was a person who had to write down everything. He had to keep the account of everything, not financial account, but everything in written. He had to maintain the records. Also, if any letter had to be sent, any kind of news had to be spread, so he was responsible of writing those letters or spreading those newsletters. Next is Dattaji Trimbak Waknis. He was the mantri, okay, correspondence. So whenever whatever Shivaji Maharaj had, any decision was to be made or anything, he was a mantri who was correspondence, who he would represent the people and he would also represent the king in front of the people. Fifth is Hambirao Mohite. He was a senapati. Organization of the army and protection of the kingdom was his work. Okay, so he had to basically look after the safety and the security of the kingdom, organizing the army, arranging them, okay, looking after the arms and ammunition, okay, looking after the training of the army. All this was done under the senapati, okay, who was Hambirao Mohite. Sixth Ashtapradhan Mandal was Ramchandra Trimbak Dabir, who was Sumant, okay, foreign relations was his work. So whenever they had to have any foreign talks with any foreign delegate, whether it was a Portuguese, a British, a Dutch, even the Mughals or even the Nizam Shahi, whoever foreign delegate or whatever discussions had to be made, whatever treaties had to be made. So in this cases, the Sumant was always there and his work was to maintain foreign relations. Seventh minister was Niraji Ravaji. He was Nyayadhish and his work was dispensing justice. Because it was not easy for Shivaji Maharaj to always look after the problems of people and then try to give verdicts to them or solution to them, because he had other administrative work also, and it was not always practical to give justice everywhere, because he was he had to look after other affairs. So he had appointed a Nyayadhish or a judge, okay, Niraji Ravaji, who would look after the justice of the kingdom. And the last Neta is Moreshwar Pandit Rao. He was the Pandit Rao. From the name itself, we get to know that his work was looking after the religious matters. Whatever the religious rituals, we know that in the medieval time, there was a lot of importance to the religious affairs. So before any war or before any ceremony, before any treaty also, they had to look after or they consulted the Pandit Rao, and he would say whichever what time is good for any battle to be fought, or when to go, what to do. So he was a person who would give, who would look after the religious matters of the kingdom, and also give decisions on the basis of the religious background. So this is all about the eight ministers, the Ashtapradhan Mandal, who helped in the administration of Shivaji Maharaj, and they looked after all these important departments. The policy regarding agriculture. Agriculture was the main occupation in villages. Maharaj knew the importance of agriculture. That was why he paid attention to the welfare of farmers. He entrusted the responsibility of organizing the land revenue system to his capable and experienced officer, office bearer, Annaji Datto. He warned the officers that they should not collect more revenue than the amount that was fixed. He encouraged peasants to bring uncultivated land under cultivation. If the crop was lost due to excessive rains or drought, or if any enemy army had devastated the area of the village, remissions were granted in land revenue and other taxes. Maharaj had instructed his officers to provide peasants with bullocks, ploughs, and good seeds for sowing. So this was how Shivaji Maharaj was very compassionate towards the farmers, because he knew that most of the population was dependent on farming, and most of the people, they were all peasants. In the villages, the main occupation was farming, and so Shivaji Maharaj gave more importance to that. He did not force them to do something which was not their field, or he also not unnecessarily force them to take up any other profession. Instead, he helped them in farming, and he also saw to it that whatever revenue, whatever taxes collected from them is proper, or is in the equivalent to whatever they are earning. If they are not earning much, then and if they are forced to pay heavy taxes, then they will be in heavy loss, and then they will also have to go through poverty, hunger, and all these issues. So Shivaji Maharaj gave this responsibility to Annaji Datto to see to it that the revenue was collected only as much they earned, okay, looking at their income. And also he saw to it that the farmers should not be forced to pay more than what they are earning, or whatever yield they are getting. Because sometimes in a year, maybe if there is no proper rain and there is less cultivation, or there is a drought, or any enemy army had devastated the area, then in this situation the farmers had to face heavy loss. So Shivaji Maharaj, he in this situation, he provided some kind of concessions, some kind of grants to the land revenue and other taxes. And he also encouraged peasants to bring uncultivated land under cultivation. Whichever land was barren, whichever was like that only, whichever plot of land was not under any use, that land Shivaji Maharaj encouraged the peasants to use for cultivation, so that they will get more profit and they will get more benefit. Also, Shivaji Maharaj made his officers, he instructed them to provide peasants with the bullocks, ploughs. Okay, so this is how he was helping old poor farmers to come up with the farming and then expand their farming. And he also helped them to get good seeds for sowing, so that good seeds would bring good yield. So this is how he was very compassionate to the farmers, and he was helping them. Village economy of that period. Agriculture was the backbone of the rural economy. In villages, many occupations developed to supplement agriculture. Artisans in the village produced goods and fulfilled the needs of the local people. In this sense, a village was a self-sufficient unit. Farmers gave a definite share from their produce to artisans. This share was called baluta, and this system was called as barter system. In a village was usually self-reliant. They got everything that they wanted in their own village. They did not have to go anywhere out. कि द फूड ग्रेन्स वर ग्रोन इन द ओन विलेज एंड द आर्टिसंस आर द वंस हु डिड अदर जॉब्स लाइक द वी कैन टॉक अबाउट द ब्लैक स्मिथ्स और द गोल्ड स्मिथ्स और द पॉटर्स एंड डिफरेंट पीपल हु डिड ऑल द अदर वर्क. You can see in the image that this person is having a small charkha in front of him. So he is trying to prepare a cloth. So whenever the farmers were in need of these artisans, whenever they needed any produce from these artisans, they were giving them their grains or rice, wheat, whatever they had, they gave them their share and then they would get whatever produce they wanted from them. So this is how they were exchanging, and that is called as barter system, where they did not have to pay actual money, but they were exchanging their produce. So this is how the villages were self-sufficient, and whatever economy of the village was there, that was in the village itself. And also when there was extra produce or extra goods produced, those were sold in the markets that they had. Okay, they had weekly markets, okay, on the district level and all, where in a week, once a week or twice a week or in a month also, they had these huge markets where they went and they sold their produce. The farmers also sold their produce and the artisans also, they sold their produce. And this is how the village economy was increasing. And Shivaji Maharaj, in his time, he encouraged a lot, okay, he encouraged this village economy to increase, because this is how that money or that would make the people self-sufficient. The people would not be dependent on the king. The people will be able to feed themselves and the people will be self-reliant. So Shivaji Maharaj was of an opinion that if the village economy is increasing, it will be helpful not only for the people but also for the kingdom. So in this manner, Shivaji Maharaj not only encouraged agriculture, but he also encouraged the different artisans. And Baluta, I told you all, is a kind of the share that they were giving. And that share was called as Baluta. That system is called as barter system. Trade and business. Maharaj knew that a kingdom does not prosper without an increase in trade, and that I explained in the previous slide also, that he was of this opinion that if the people are progressing, if economy rises, then it will ultimately help the kingdom. So he was of this opinion that there should be increase or there should be rise in the trade and business. Give and take has to happen, and this is how the kingdom also prospers. There is flow of money, and also the power of the kingdom or the name of the kingdom is spread to the other regions also. So for that purpose, trade is very necessary. Merchants bring novel goods as also certain necessities into a kingdom. Novel is new. Okay, only when other kingdom, other people, they bring their produce, we get to explore the outside world. We get to know what is there outside. So Shivaji Maharaj was very open-minded for trade and business. Goods became available in plenty. Trade prospers, adding to wealth. The view that Maharaj took of merchants is seen in the Ajnapatra, where merchants are described as follows. Merchants are the ornaments of the kingdom and the glory of the king. Shivaji Maharaj believed that if there are merchants going and coming in your kingdom, then that is kind of an ornament. Your kingdom looks beautiful. Otherwise, then it looks like nobody is coming in your kingdom and your kingdom is all dry and there is no trade, there is no business. So when these merchants, they come and go, this is kind of adding more beauty and more glory to the king and the kingdom. It was a policy of Maharaj to protect industries. An excellent example of this is the salt industry. Now, when we are talking about industry, we know that in the medieval time, there were no big cottage industries and all, but there were small scale industries, household industries, which were of the artisans especially. And this, the Shivaji Maharaj, he tried to protect the salt industry. He protected the salt industry in Konkan. At that time, traders imported salt from the Portuguese territory and sold in Swaraj. Salt was something that we don't find in every village. It is got only where there is coast, there is sea around. Okay, because we know how salt is gained. कि द सी वाटर इज स्टोर्ड एंड देन इट ड्राइज इट द वाटर इवेपोरेट्स एंड देन द सॉल्ट पार्टिकल्स आर लेफ्ट बिहाइंड एंड द सॉल्ट इज कलेक्टेड इट इज रिफाइंड एंड इट इज सोल्ड सो सॉल्ट वॉज फाउंड ओनली इन द कोंकण रीजन्स द रेस्ट ऑफ द सॉल्ट रेस्ट ऑफ द रीजन दे गॉट सॉल्ट विच वॉज इम्पोर्टेड फ्रॉम पोर्चुगीज दैट अफेक्टेड द लोकल ट्रेड इन कोंकण एरियाज सो महाराज चार्ज हैवी ड्यूटी ऑन द सॉल्ट इम्पोर्टेड इन टू स्वराज फ्रॉम द पोर्चुगीज टेरिटरीज he put more tax on the salt which was from Portuguese. People were attracted to the salt which came from Portuguese. They found that it is from a foreign country. It is imported. So let us take that one because it was cheap also. So when more salt was taken from the Portuguese traders, the market, local market or the salt from the Konkan region was wasted. It was not taken by anybody and people were going in loss. So Shivaji Maharaj, what plan he applied is, he put more tax on the Portuguese territories and he put more tax on the salt which was imported from Portuguese. And the intention was that the salt imported from the Portuguese territory would then cost more and as a result its import would decrease and the sale of the local salt would increase. Okay, people definitely, if they had to pay more tax over Portuguese salt, they would stop buying it. And they would ultimately come back to the regional salt or the local salt. And that would increase the sale of the local salt. And ultimately, it would help the territory or help the help to increase the economy of the kingdom. So this is how tactfully Shivaji Maharaj was also looking into the affairs of the traders. The business and trade was very important for him and he gave a lot of importance to it. He looked into it personally and he tried to resolve and if there were any issues there. The remaining part of the lesson we shall continue in the next module. Thank you.